The evidence is strong. Something is lurking in the furthest reaches of our solar system, disturbing the orbits of planets, comets, and asteroids. Something big. But while many speculate on the possibility of an undiscovered Planet X, the truth of what may actually be lurking out in the cold dark of space might be a lot more terrifying. In the mid-1800s, the evidence was adding up that something was present in the furthest reaches of our solar system. What the scientists of the time didn't know was that something had actually been directly observed multiple times after the invention of the telescope. Neptune, the hidden planet, had actually been spotted as far back as Galileo himself, who had mistaken it for a fixed star. But with the application of Newton's laws of motion and gravity to the discovery of Uranus, it was soon clear that something was wrong. Uranus had been discovered in 1781, but advancements in observational technology in the years following allowed astronomers to harness the power of Newton's laws to do something unprecedented – accurately predict the planet's movements. The laws were ironclad. They had yielded perfect results for every planet before Uranus, but when they were applied to Uranus itself, the math didn't work. There was something else out there having an invisible effect on Uranus, something that was very difficult to see even with the most powerful telescopes. At least, that was one of the theories proposed. Others believed that at the great distance that Uranus orbited the Sun, Newton's laws simply didn't work like they do closer to the Sun. For John Couch Adams, such thinking was heretical. By using Newton's own laws, Adams set about to prove that there was something else having an effect on Uranus. He aimed to accurately deduce exactly how big this perturbing object was and where it could finally be directly observed. Parallel to Adams, though, French astronomer and mathematician Urbain Jean-Joseph Le Verrier was also working on this perturbation problem plaguing Uranus. Independent of Adams's work, he would give the location of Neptune down to a single degree of where it would eventually be discovered. But after Neptune was officially discovered and its mass calculated, the math still wasn't working out. Scientists realized that there had yet to be another object impacting Uranus's orbit. After all, if the first perturbation theory had been correct, then it proved that Newton's laws didn't stop working past the asteroid belt. In 1906, Percival Lowell would launch the hunt for Planet X, a theorized ninth planet, using the same mathematical principles that had led to the discovery of Neptune. With the telescope he had personally funded at the Lowell Observatory, he aimed his gaze toward those calculated points in the sky. Yet, the hunt was to no avail. But Lowell had actually captured at least two images of Pluto. They were just so faint that they went undiscovered for decades. It wouldn't be until February 18, 1930 that Pluto was clearly photographed. A barely discernible but clearly moving speck of light on photographic plates. Since then, Pluto has lost its planetary status and science has been pretty comfortable with the composition of the solar system as we know it. Yet, as our ability to more precisely observe the distant limits of our own solar system improved, it was clear that there was a problem. First, we need to discuss just how incredibly difficult it is to even observe objects out past Pluto. The Oort cloud, first proposed by Dutch astronomer Jan Oort in 1950, is a vast cloud of icy objects that surround our solar system. It's believed that most of these objects are debris left over from the formation of the planets and the inner asteroids, flung out into deep space by the interaction of the various planetary gravitational fields. Yet, the Sun's gravity prevents them from escaping into interstellar space, even as weak as it is at 5,000 astronomical units, or AU, where the Oort cloud begins. Some of these objects, however, are also believed to be intergalactic in origin, captured once more by the Sun's gravity field. Scientists even believe that our solar system regularly swaps material with other solar systems as we drift past each other in our orbit around the giant black hole at the center of our galaxy. And this makes the possibility of a true Planet X even more exciting, because lurking in our own solar system may be a planet from a completely different solar system. But finding it is harder than it sounds. At this distance, objects barely reflect any of the light that they receive from our Sun, making them practically invisible to our telescopes. Radar is nearly useless given how widely dispersed an outgoing wave is and how weak the return all the way back to Earth would be. While we're able to image large objects close to their own suns in faraway solar systems, trying to gather details on anything lurking in our own fringes is almost impossible, even if it's as big as a planet. How we might find Planet X is actually the reason why a growing number of scientists even believe it exists in the first place. As we've gotten better at calculating the orbits and the movement of comets and even some objects in the outer solar system, the math is once more not quite working. Irregularities in the orbits of trans-Neptunian and scattered disk objects, bodies lingering beyond Neptune, suggest the presence of an unseen force. These gravitational disturbances hint at a hidden giant, an unaccounted-for source of gravity, subtly shaping their movements through the solar system's distant reaches. These objects have highly tilted or elongated orbits that can bring them in as close as 30 astronomical units to the Sun before flinging them back out to over 100 AUs away. This makes them the oldest and the coldest objects in the solar system, which might have preserved all kinds of information about our primordial solar system if we could ever get to one. But given their highly eccentric orbits, getting to them will be a monumental task in and of itself. This distorted orbit doesn't seem to be accounted for by the regular influence of the known planets. And to make the case even more curious, these objects seem to cluster together at points in their orbits, strongly hinting at a large planetary-sized object having an impact on their path around the Sun. Then there's the way that some of these objects have been recorded moving through their orbits. Newtonian physics allows us to extremely accurately predict the orbital path of an object through a gravity field. It has never failed us yet, even in the most extreme circumstances like the discovery of Neptune and Pluto. And yet, some of these objects have been observed to shift their orbit in a way that doesn't align with the math when the known planets are taken into consideration. And as these objects approach the Sun at the closest point between the two bodies, known as the orbital perihelion, this predictable point in space is also observed to move unexpectedly. When only the gravitational influence of the outer planets is taken into account, it fails to model the observed shifting of the perihelion of some of these objects. The evidence is in. Something we failed to account for is having an effect on some of the most distant objects in our solar system. And when scientists plug in a hypothetical Planet X into computer simulations, it often resolves all observed problems with the movement of these trans-Neptunian objects. So, if it's likely that Planet X is there, how do we find it? And what happens when, as some of the evidence suggests, Planet X is not a planet at all, but something far more terrifying and destructive lurking in our own neighborhood? Any hunt for Planet X, no matter how big it is, and scientists estimate it's likely at least 5 to 10 Earth masses, is going to be extremely difficult. At such great distances, objects give off very little shine from the Sun striking their surface, and their infrared signature is incredibly faint. However, telescopes like the James Webb Telescope and other very sensitive infrared telescopes could be repurposed for the task. James Webb is sensitive enough to detect the faintest infrared signatures of bodies entire light years away and has led to truly groundbreaking observations of space. The problem is, James Webb can see approximately 39% of the sky on any given day, but if looking for something as faint as Planet X would be, it would need to be told with much greater precision where to look. This is where calculating the gravitational effects of Planet X on known objects can narrow the search, just like with Neptune and Pluto. Scientists can track known trans-Neptunian objects in their orbits and then plug them into advanced computer models that use Newtonian physics to work at the problem in reverse. This would allow them to arrive at a conclusion as to the characteristics of an unknown object in order to account for observed orbital irregularities. It tells scientists what to look for, and taking the data they can, then starts to model where such an object is expected to be at any given time. An extremely sensitive infrared telescope could be used to account for all infrared sources in its field of view, and compare that data with known objects to look for any newly discovered objects. The math should be precise enough that even with the inevitable discovery of other trans-Neptunian objects, in such a survey, Planet X could still be uniquely identified. Another option is to use a method similar to how we hunt for planets in other solar systems. We can't directly image planets around distant stars. Instead, we carefully observe those stars for long periods of time and then look for shifts in the total amount of light the star is giving out. Any dip in this light graph means that an object is moving between us and the star we're observing. This allows us to calculate the size of the object with very high precision, and thus revealing the presence of distant planets in orbit. A similar occultation method could be used to find Planet X. We would need to observe the light of background stars and then wait to see if that incoming light shifts or drops any. By tracking drops in incoming light from those background stars, we could literally track the movement of Planet X across the sky. This would give us the exact location of where to aim our telescopes to directly image it. Right now, the matter is one of funding rather than ability or even evidence. Unfortunately, large agencies like NASA and the ESA have limited budgets, and there are a lot of competing priorities. Finding Planet X at the moment is not high on the list of priorities as humanity gears up to return to the moon and build a new international space station, or even set foot on another planet for the first time in history. But what happens if Planet X isn't a planet at all? What if it's something far more terrifying? All we currently know is that something is likely having an observed gravitational effect in the outer solar system. This tells us something is there, not what the something is, and that something could end up being really scary stuff like a black hole or even dark matter. Scientists don't know what dark matter is, hence the name. What we do know, though, is that based on our observations of the universe, once more using Newtonian physics, the math is not working at a truly epic scale. To explain the observed orbits of objects as big as galaxies, the universe is made up of 80% dark matter. But it remains unseen by scientists. To say that this is a crisis of science would be an understatement. Imagine if you could only account for 20% of anything. Imagine if you poured a bowl of cereal and your cereal was floating, suspended in a liquid of some sort, but you could only identify 20% of that liquid as milk. The rest of what's in your cereal bowl you can't even directly observe. So we have no clue what dark matter actually is, but a chunk of it sitting out in orbit past Neptune somewhere could explain what's going on with the outermost parts of the solar system. How will this affect the Earth and us as we expand into space is a complete unknown. And what happens if this chunk of dark matter happens to have its own orbit, inevitably perturbed and sent on a collision course with the solar system or the Sun itself? The results could be catastrophic. As catastrophic as if what's actually lurking out there in space is the most destructive force in nature, a black hole. Now, we tend to think of black holes as being distant objects that swallow up stars. Our own galaxy, and it's believed most galaxies, orbits a supermassive black hole. How could one of these star killers be living in our own neighborhood? The common misconception is that black holes suck in everything around them, when the truth is they don't actually pull in any matter. It's only matter that crosses their event horizon that gets sucked in. You could orbit around a black hole perfectly safely in an established orbit that was right outside the event horizon for billions of years. Not all black holes are monsters either. It's likely they come in a variety of different sizes. A small black hole could be lurking in our own solar system, having just enough of an effect to perturb the orbit of most distant objects. That's not really the problem, though. The problem is what happens when the black hole's own orbit gets perturbed. This is how comets come to be – distant, icy bodies that eventually succumb to the relentless pull of gravity in the solar system. Over time, their orbits shift, drawing them inward, sometimes plunging them deep into the inner solar system or even grazing the Sun's outer layers. There's no reason why this couldn't happen to a black hole, especially because orbital mechanics are incredibly complex. While it might take millions or even billions of years, gravitational perturbations could add up to a dramatic effect on a lurking black hole's orbit, sending it shooting straight into the inner solar system and even the Earth. The Earth being stuck by a black hole would be catastrophic, as the hole itself would grow in size the more mass it consumed. This in turn would increase its own gravitational pull, sucking in even more material. Even if one missed the Earth, by consuming enough material along its path, it might alter the Earth's orbit, pulling us closer to the Sun's scorching heat or flinging us further into the void. And if it was traveling slowly enough, its immense gravitational forces could tear our planet apart entirely. A catastrophic end to life as we know it. What do you think about the mysterious Planet X? Could it really be lurking in the far reaches of our solar system? Or is it just a cosmic myth? Drop your thoughts below. Now go find out why it would suck to live through the end of the universe, or click this other video here.